conservation of forest, wildlife, nature that we are talking today is in fact turns out to be conservation and life itself. Why should we conserve forest now? Common man on the street, when you ask whether forest and wildlife has to be conserved, he says, yes sir, forest has to be conserved. Then you ask simply why? From forest gives us clean air, clean water, and some even say it regulates climate. How the good? Then you ask a simple question. Aitu kaadu idre male barutta, male idre kaadu beliyutta. Bangalore receives more rain than Bandipur. What do you say? Oh, how the sir? Gotila sir. I will not leave you with that puzzle. By the end of this presentation, I will empower you to answer this question. So let's deep dive into this very important topic. Forest is a living ecosystem. Life on this earth is 3.5 billion years old. Now, life survived for so long, not because of any one dominant species, humans. It is because of a powerful phenomenon called diversity. That is biodiversity. When you visit forest, you see trees, shrub, herb, climbers, insects, birds, snakes, fungi, algae, and n number of innumerable species which are not visible to naked eye. An estimate says there are nearly 10 million life forms on this earth. And these 10 million life forms interact among themselves in 1,000 different ways. Predators, prey, decomposer, pollinator, scavenger, many known and many unknown interactions. This diversity of life and innumerable interactions among them creates web, and this is a solid bedrock of life. Life survived on this earth because of this bedrock of web of life, and helps life also to survive shocks, handle unforeseen threats over millions of years. So when next time when we say forest, it is not woodlot, it is a living ecosystem. Okay, then some of you sitting here, sir, the forest is required for many life forms. I as a life form living in this, you know, living in this cozy AC room, why should I have forest? Friends, you will be surprised. Health of the forest is directly proportional, directly related to health of the people sitting here. Let me elaborate this. Malaria is one of the deadliest diseases humankind has ever faced, which has taken more lives than all wars, famines put together. What is the drug for malaria? You may say quinine tablet. Next question is, where did quinine come from? It is from bark of a small tree called cinchona. If cinchona bark was not there, your quinine would not have been here. So many lives would have been lost. That is only one example. Aspirin that we take every day, painkiller, is from a willow tree. Taxol, the drug that used in cancer, is from yew tree. Vincristine, which is used against leukemia, is from a small plant called periwinkle. If you simply Google out, nearly 25% of modern medicine has their origin back to forest. Then you may ask, why did forest give so many medicines for us? When I am not caring forest, why forest is caring me? Friends, simple answer is, for forest, you and me are also one life form. Mother Earth, we are also one life form. Even though you don't care it, it cares you. Forest is a laboratory of life, where life continuously upgrades its survivability over millions of years by a simple equation called survival of the fittest and evolution. Evolution is small changes in nature that improves the survivability of the all life forms, and thereby it throws a lot of solutions, and many of those solutions which we might be using to, you know, improve our health or other things. So now at least few of those who are taking drugs will appreciate, okay, card irbeku namagoskara. For other fortunate few who are not taking drugs as an it, let's get into the other dimensions of forest. Friends, let me, you know, recollect all of you with the turning point in the history of India. That is Green Revolution. What is Green Revolution? When country was facing shortage of food, when food has to be rationed among citizens, okay, what was required was increase food production and increase food productivity. The then high yielding varieties had one some small problem. These varieties were tall, succulent. The more fertilizer or nutrients you give, they grow tall and they fall off because of their own weight. Now what was required was simply convert them into dwarf and robust varieties. When that is the problem, where is the solution? Solution is in nature. You just go back in the forest and then search, where is my solution? If your intention is clear and if your objective is true, you get solution there. Small tiny gene, DGU gen, from dwarf and robust rice, RHT1, reduced height 1 gene. Again, dwarf and robust gene in wheat varieties. These two plants were living insignificant for thousands of years or what, millions of years in forest. Nobody had valued them. But scientists found that character. And we had the biotechnology, and then it was plant breeding technology. Transferred these characters or genes to our high-yielding varieties. And there is a solution. My tall, succulent, high-yielding variety became dwarf, robust, new variety called Kalyan Sona and Sonalika. Now I can give any amount of fertilizer inputs and you get more food. The country's food problem was solved. Just imagine, had anybody fixed royalty for this gene? Now for 50 years, 1 billion population, 365 days, for every day you put 100 rupees, that is the value of that insignificant gene or plant that was living in wild. You will not have so many zeros to put that valuation. So that is the value of forest. Okay, now, forest is solving my health. Forest is solving my food problem. Today I'm fine with all those things. Why should I need forest? My third question to all of you is, what is the biggest problem today? Everybody will see on the ground that's our pollution. Pollution is the biggest problem today. What is pollution to do with forest? Forest has no pollution. Friends, exactly that is why I'm raising this issue. Why do forest has no pollution? Now, it is simply because, see, every activity, whether it is anthropogenic or industry, has a product and a byproduct. If the quantity and toxicity of the byproduct increases the assimilative capacity of the nature, then it turns out to be a pollutant and manifests as pollution. Now, Bangalore has only one life form. Bandipur has millions of life forms. There is no pollution there. Nature has found a simple formula where metabolic waste of one life form becomes raw material for the second life form. Metabolic waste of second life form becomes the raw material for third life form. The cycle goes till the metabolic waste of nth life form is the raw material for first life form. Now every waste is being used, circulated, there is no waste, there is no pollution. How simply, how beautifully it has managed pollution for millions of years. We human beings, had we understood this simple formula that nature is putting before us during our industrial revolution and embarked on industrial diversification along with industrial revolution, today we would not have pollution problem before us. So, had we understood this principle of you know, recyclability from forest, and simply adopted industrial diversification alongside industrial revolution, today we would not have been in this mess of pollution. So forest is a university of knowledge. It's only for us to, you know, see how we should learn from it. It is not a woodlot. Then, you know, yes, it is taking care of my health, it is taking care of my food, and it is also teaching me something. Then what? The young boys and girls sitting here, it's okay, past, present is taken care of. What is for my future? Does forest has something for my future? Friends, in fact, if you see the potential requirement of forest for future, I want to highlight one thing here. Nature had set one rule where genes are transmitted, transferred within species. There is only intra-species transfer of genes. It is the law set by nature for itself. These genes are transferred by reproduction, recombination, mutation kind of a thing. But we human beings have broken this barrier set by nature. Today, the power of biotechnology, I can transfer genes across species. I can transfer BT gene from Bacillus thuringiensis to a cotton plant and get insect resistance. I can transfer GFP gene from jellyfish to any organism and make it biomedical miraging for diagnostic purposes. So and so, even human insulin gene is transferred to E. coli for mass production of insulin that so many people are using today. That is the potential that we have. But this potential can only be realized only when we have genes. Still, we can only transfer genes, we cannot create genes. Because these genes are created in nature by process of evolution that is taking not thousands, millions of years. And I don't think we have millions of years to really create genes, then we can use biotechnology to transfer genes. So unless otherwise I protect my forest, protect my gene library, I will not be able to realize potentials of biotechnology and then address or solve the problems that humankind might face today or tomorrow. So this is the holistic, you know, value of forest. It is not simple woodlot. Unfortunately, we common man has narrowed down their argument of forest is woodlot. No. It is, you know, it gives you so much of services for us. Fine. When it is doing so much for me, where do we stand today? Are we taking care of it? You will be surprised to know. I am giving pictures, you know, stats of Karnataka, and which is same for the whole country. 80% of the geographical area is inhabited by one species. I need not say who. Now, 20% is forest. Oh, you might say 20%, okay, acha hai. But this 20% forest is also being used by one species for timber, for firewood, for minor forest produce, for grazing. You know, recently, Chamarajanagar was in all over the place for grazing, so I'm taking that reference. So even that 20% is also not free from these disturbances. Only 20% of the 20 hectare, effectively 4%, 4 hectare out of 100 hectare, is today notified as protected area or wildlife area where human interferences, disturbance should not be there and nature should evolve without human interference. But the reality is, even in that 4%, people are there. Kali Tiger Reserve has 2,000 families. Nagarhole Tiger Reserve has around 1,800 families. BRT Tiger Reserve has another 1,500 families. So they are there. It's okay. These families, for thousands of years, were living simple life and their sync with nature. There was not much of disturbance because of their life style to the forest. But we civilized human beings, in our pursuit to urbanize the tribal inhabitants in the forest, are threatening the very fabric of forest, fabric of life, and urbanizing virgin forest can lead to catastrophic consequences. There has to be a wide-scale public understanding of comprehensive value of forest, so that habitations, wilderness, there can be a safe boundary between these two, where humans also can live and forest and wildlife also can live. And this is possible. When I was director Kali Tiger Reserve, I put forth this thought process with everybody. In fact, sometimes the tribals living in forest, by giving them infrastructure, their poverty will not be alleviated. We should understand these two things. Alleviation of poverty and life, these two are two different things. There cannot be creation of employment opportunities inside deep forest. So without employment opportunities, they cannot have economic upliftment. Without economic upliftment, their poverty cannot be alleviated. But by intervening all this, civil structures, roads, that kind of a thing, the disturbance that they can create in only this 4% of the forest is catastrophic. Nearly 500 families, and it's a continuous process, nearly 500 families were brought from the deep jungle into mainstream of the society, where now they get all facilities that you and I are expected to get. Alongside, we will be creating inviolate areas for forest nature to evolve without human interferences and preserve biodiversity, genetic diversity, knowledge, wisdom that will grow up for humankind to evolve and then humankind to help. In fact, many of the countries today, even for IT revolution, we talk of rare earth materials. The country which holds rare earth metals will become powerhouse of IT industry. Similarly, the country who holds the genetic library will become the powerhouse of BT revolution. And we have all the opportunities of powerhousing BT revolution and be a country of the future, provided we really understand the 360 degree view of the forest and conserve it. And then we all should make a wish and resolve to make it happen. Thank you, one and all.